Good morning. My topic is transitional provisions in GST. Transitional provisions are provisions to make special provision for application of legislation to meet certain circumstances that will happen in the transition period. That is, from VAT to GST, from central excise to GST, from service tax to GST. There may happen certain events which may not be easy to handle with the earlier provisions which you were aware during the training. So to take care of these events during the period of transition, transitional provisions are made. This is the chapter having largest number of sections in the model draft law. Now it is 27, and I think more sections may add because more circumstances or events may arise based on the suggestions from the field. These sections are general provisions, section 141, then migration of existing taxpayers relating to registration, section 142, SenVAT credit related issues and VAT credit related issues, how these scenarios has to be handled in the transitional period. Then input credit on stock related issues, section 145 and section 146. Then there is some other provisions like amount payable for switching over to composition scheme that is related to transition of a dealer having paying normal tax to composition scheme under GST. Then how to deal with goods return under different circumstances. Then we have job work related scenarios, price revision related scenarios, and recovery and refund, and the adjudication proceedings related to that. How to deal with these scenarios. Then we have miscellaneous provisions, section 159 to 162E. ABCDE like sections are added because these were added during the drafting after finalizing the major heads, and these ABCDE will change in the final law, and it will be termed as a 162, 164, just and more to add. Now we can discuss in detail what are these provisions. General provisions, section 141. This is related to government officials discharging functions under the earlier law and on the appointed day. Now it is decided that it will be 1st April 2017. On that day, they will become officers of the GST. This is the enabling provision. So also, this provision has a major point for enabling the government, both central and state governments, empowered to issue orders and make rules for smooth transition to GST, so long as such matters are not in conflict with the Act. It is a wide power given to the central and state government because it may not be possible to envision everything, every event in the transition in the Act itself. There may happen some other events. So as to make care of that events, governments are given power under section 141 to make suitable rules and notifications which are not inconsistent with the Act. This is the major provision. Now we have migration of existing taxpayers to GST. I think in registration, he might have discussed this area. That is, in registration, dealers having registration under the previous earlier law will be given a provisional registration and a certificate will be issued. This certificate will be valid for 6 months. And then what happens during the 6 months? During the 6 months, a taxable person has to furnish the relevant information in the GSTM portal. Then he will get a original certificate. Final registration certificate under GST will be issued. Why the certificate which is issued under earlier law or data covered under earlier law is not taken care in the GST law is because the data standards of the different states and authorities are different. So for a uniform purpose, we are capturing the data again. Next, if the taxable person does not furnish required information within 6 months, then what will happen? Provisional certificate may be cancelled. There are two issues. The authority can either cancel the provisional certificate or he can retain it, even though the dealer is not furnishing the required information. Because if the dealer is not furnishing the required information, doesn't mean that he is not having business. If he is having business and he is not furnishing the relevant information, then the authority can proceed. Then there is an option for the dealers who are coming to GST and a provisional certificate is issued, he can apply for cancellation. Provisional certificate is cancelled upon dealer's application. It is only happens under circumstances when there is, he is not liable to pay tax under GST. A dealer is having a business of rupees 10 lakhs above turnover in the earlier law, but after coming into business under the GST, he is having a low turnover or he is stopping the business, then he can apply for cancelling the provisional registration, and that cancellation will have effect from the date of GST. So it is deemed as a certificate is not issued under GST. This is related to migration of taxpayers. Now we have an important transitional provisions, section 143 to 147. These are related to handling pre-GST SEN VAT and VAT credit. There are five scenarios. We have section 143 to 147 relating to each scenario. First scenario is how we can deal with carry forward of ITC in last return. Then we have unavailed credit on capital goods. Then how to deal with manufactured or sale of goods exempt earlier and taxable now. Then composition related issue. Then vice versa, coming to normal scheme. Now we can discuss in detail. Section 143 is related to SEN VAT or VAT credit, carry forward, in the last return which is filed under the earlier law. If a person is having SEN VAT credit in the last return filed under the earlier law, that is Service Tax Act or Central Excise Act or VAT Act, then he will be eligible for carry forwarding the credit to the first return in the GST. And another scenario is also there, section 144, which states that if a dealer is having unavailed portion of capital, unavailed portion of ITC on capital goods, which is available for adjustment in the last return, then that also can be carried forward to the GST. The only issue is that credit will be available in GST, but SEN VAT is given credit in CGST and VAT is given credit in SGST. There is no other way. Only the respective taxes will be given credit. That we have to ensure. In the model law, they are giving separate paragraphs for SGST and CGST. They will be, if you note down, you can see. Then there is some subjectivity or conditions. The amount has to be admissible as SEN VAT credit under the earlier law and also under the GST law. That is, for example, a commodity which is exempt under the earlier law cannot be taken, even though it is taxable under the GST law, cannot be, he is not eligible for carry forward of credit. So it must be eligible for ITC in both laws. That is the provision. And if there is any amount which is recoverable due to unqualified claim of ITC, then that amount will be recovered as an arrear of GST. That is the provision. Now we can see an example. For example, SEN VAT credit or VAT credit carry forward in the last return. If TVS is filing a VAT return for the month of March 2017 and he is having a 10 lakh rupees of ITC for carry forward, then in the first return of the GST, he is eligible for taking credit. But under the Kerala VAT Act, there is no carry forward of ITC. We are issuing refund. So such scenarios will depends upon the provisions of the SGST, earlier law, which is existing in different states. In the capital goods case, MRF is purchasing a machinery worth rupees 1 crore in July 2016, in an earlier period, and they have an ITC claim of rupees 5 lakhs, and we are giving as per the earlier law, we are giving as 36 equal monthly installments, and the dealer is claiming ITC in monthly installments till the return, last return, that is the March 2017 return, he is claiming ITC, monthly installments. And how it can be dealt with? MRF can claim the unavailed ITC in the GST return for the month of April 2017. Because we are not giving installments, we are in lump sum, we are allowing ITC. So ITC claimed in VAT is computed till the earlier law, and ITC allowable GST in allowed in lump sum in the first return. This is the procedure. Now another scenario, that is input credit on stock of goods held. Section 145 and Section 146. These are two sections which are dealing exclusively with two scenarios related to exemption. Section 145, and these are the intention behind these scenarios. For each scenario, for each section, or even under the transitional provision, the law is drafted in such a way that there is some rationale or idea behind each provision, so as to deal a certain event. Section 145 is designed to deal with an event like earlier exempted but taxable under GST. Goods which are earlier exempted under GST, earlier law, but coming as taxable under the present law. Then, if for example, if it is zero in GST, earlier law, and 22% in GST, then the customer will suffer otherwise, because the dealer will enhance the price and collect the amount from the customer. Instead, to regularize this, we are giving credit for the goods which are earlier exempted. In the same way, Section 146 also says about earlier in composition but under normal scheme in GST. ITC, that I will explain coming. Okay. Earlier in composition means, for example, in Kerala we have a composition like percentage scheme. He is paying only 0.5%. He is not eligible for any ITC. So he will not be having ITC in the last return for carry forward. And if we are asking to pay the normal tax in the GST period, he will suffer. So to deal with that situation, we are bringing Section 146. Then what is Section composition? For composition purpose, the SGST law can decide which are the dealers in the different category who has to be treated to give a fair treatment in the GST. That the state can decide and add in this. That is why 141 is given special power to the state to deal with special circumstances, because such a composition may not be in other state laws. So then what is entitled for? Shall be entitled for credit of eligible duties, taxes, VAT. These are the three terms. Duties, taxes. Duties and taxes are defined in such a way that it is specifically given in the act that under CGST, duties and taxes means five items: excise duty, additional excise duty, national calamity contingent duty, additional duty under customs tariff act, and service tax. Only these items will be given as credit in of duties and taxes under CGST law. In VAT, it is ITC. So then another condition, these inputs held in stock on the appointed day. On the appointed day, these items must be in his stock. The only then that items will be sold in the GST. Or contained in semi-finished goods or finished goods, which are in stock on the appointed day. That is the provision. Then there is some conditions or provisions provided. What are the provisions? One. These are subjective. One, inputs are used or intended to be used for making taxable supplies in GST. Okay, if it is for exemption, then there is no claim of such ITC. Then inputs are otherwise available for SENVAT credit if the taxable person had not be a manufacturer or exempted goods, or not in composition, or not had liability under the earlier law. If such person was a manufacturer of exempted goods on the earlier period and liable to tax, then such provision can be applied. That even though he is a composition dealer on exempted goods, but the provisions, other conditions stipulated in the earlier law will apply to this also. Otherwise, what is mean by this provision is that only a dealer who is having an exempt goods or composition deal goods is brought into a platform which is similar to a taxable person in under the earlier law. How he is filing, how a taxable person under the earlier law is claiming ITC, that provision is given for this person. If there is such, for example, some negative list is for capital goods, if it is so, this person cannot be allowed to take ITC on that claim. The provisions of the earlier law will also be complete under this provision also. Then credit is available on under GST must be there. Then he must be in possession of valid invoice, which is issued not earlier than 12 months of the appointed day. Then amount of credit has to be calculated as per the generally accounting principles. That means the person who is giving credit must not account the already paid input as a cost in his accounts. If he is treating it as a cost, already paid disallowed input as a cost in his account and raising his price, then he is not eligible for such a claim. Then the amount will be recoverable as an arrear of GST if there is any proceedings against this. Now, another the opposite scenario, that amount payable in the event of a taxable person switching over to composition scheme under GST. A person was in normal scheme under the earlier law and coming to a composition scheme under the present law. Then the person will be paying only 1%, not less than 1% he will be paying. But hence it is not possible to legal or equal to give that person ITC of his last return for carry forward. So a person who is not in composition scheme earlier and having carry forward eligible credit, he and moves to composition scheme its IGST, he shall debit his electronic ledger with the ITC in his hand. So these are in the connected provisions. ITC, he has to debit. Then he cannot utilize this for payment of 1%. That is the idea. That ITC will lapse. For SGST, CGST, CGST credit. SGST, SGST related ITC. These are, so the draft law all states separate paragraph for SGST and CGST for the transition provision.
Complete input tax, I mean.
Okay.
Complete input is paid by the dealer does not mention in the return there, but sometimes it may be mentioned by, in the bill itself.
Okay.
But it is not bring into the return.
Okay.
But the invoice, the purchase invoice show the okay. excess credit. Okay. What will be treated in that?
The purchase invoices is uploaded in the system.
In the system.
Okay.
The input credit shows lesser than the return filed. Okay. What will be the position there?
Then we have a provision to deal with revision of returns in transition provision. If a person is revising, that I will come to, a person is revising his returns earlier under the earlier law and his tax liability increases or his credit increases. Under two, there are two scenarios. If the tax liability increases, he has to pay tax under the earlier law and it is recoverable under GST. And if the credit increases, he can claim refund. That is provided.
When it's carrying forward of credit.
Yes.
On goods held in stock.
Okay.
Can you insist on the invoice being not earlier than 12 months?
The law says so.
That would be what do you say, injustice. For the simple reason,
yes, yeah.
When you are permitted to carry forward credit,
yes,
you would have initially taken credit at a point of time when maybe this restriction was not there.
Okay.
Since the goods are held in stock,
the restriction provision says 12 months period specifies in several places. In several places, the provision says certain time periods. These are decided by the embodied committee and the public domain is available, the document is available in public domain for making any suggestions like this, which is against the trade, and you can make and they will consider this. Because I don't have a word on that. This is a provision. Statute I cannot change. We can recommend. Now goods return. Section 148 and 149, two provisions are included to deal with certain events relating to goods return. Section 148 is a provision which states that goods which are earlier exempted but taxable under GST. Goods which are exempted under the earlier law and now taxable, and which are returned. Three circumstances, three conditions must be satisfied. One, goods were removed or sold within prior to six months to the appointed date, and returned within 6 months from the appointed date. Which are sold or removed before 6 months and returned within 6 months. Then what will happen? And also the proper officer can satisfactorily identify these goods are those goods which are sold or removed before 6 months and returned within 6 months, then no tax is payable. Because it was under earlier law, the goods were sold or removed. That's the reason. Now, if any of the conditions is violated, then it is, if not, the tax is payable by the person who is returning the goods. Because it will amount to supply. That is the 148. This 149 is also similar. Goods, the only difference is that the goods which are not exempted, instead of that, duty paid goods are coming into the picture. Okay, the returned goods are goods on which duty or tax paid under the earlier law. And these goods are removed or sold 6 months before the earlier law, before the appointed date, and returned within 6 months after the appointed date. And proper officer can, if satisfactorily identify, these are the goods which are sold before 6 months and returned within 6 months, and tax is paid under the earlier law, then no tax is payable under GST.
Physical verification is necessary.
The rules will explain what is the procedure. I don't know. Satisfactorily identify means if there is such a claim, that is, the goods must be those goods which are so removed before 6 months and returned within 6 months. By documents and other proof, he has to substantiate. If not, any of the conditions are violated, what will happen? Tax is payable by the person returning the goods.
So if he is carrying the sales invoice, if he is in possession of the sales invoice, and when the goods are returned.
Sales invoices doesn't mean that it is the same goods.
No.
For example, description, any barcode, commodity specific.
Can be there in the invoice.
That is why it is given a satisfactorily identify. It gives a quite power. Yes. Then tax is payable by the person returning the goods. If the tax is paid, no problem. The tax is taxable person receiving such goods within 6 months entitled to take credit of the duty paid. That is, there is a compensatory provision is also there, if such even happens. Now we have job work. Job work is a little confusing area. Section 150 to 152. Deals with inputs. 152 deals with semi-finished goods. 152 deals with finished goods sent for job work. The provisions are names are different, but the provisions are similar. Conditions and application. The conditions are there. If the job work related goods are removed or dispatched your job work prior to the appointed day and returned within 6 months, that 6 months can be extended by 2 months by the officer. Then manufacturer or job work, both of them declare these goods in their stock, invoice stock filed. Then no tax is payable. Both of them are declaring in their books of accounts as they are having the book, they are having the goods, and the transaction happens in such a way that it is happens prior to the appointed date and returned within 6 months. Then no tax is payable. If two other circumstances are there, taxable payable by the job worker person returning the goods after 6 months. If the goods given for job work are returned after 6 months of the appointed day, then tax is payable by the person who is returning. And there is other provision also there, not returned within 6 months. We are giving goods for job work before the appointed date, and these goods are not returned within 6 months, then the person who had sent the goods for job work has to pay the tax, treating it as supply. Manufacturer can transfer. There is a condition there, provision there. Manufacturer can transfer finished goods to the premises of any registered taxable person for export without tax. because export is tax is not exported. This is the Joburg scenario. Once again, I will explain. Goods are removed or dispatched for Joburg before the appointed date and received within 6 months. And both of them declare the details of the goods, then there is no tax. If the second event, if the goods is sent for Joburg before the appointed date and not returned within 6 months, then the manufacturer has to pay, and returned after 6 months, the person who is returning, that is the job worker, has to pay the tax. This is a provision. We have an issue in that slide. Okay, I will explain. Price revision section 153. Price is revised after the appointed day in respect of a previous contract. In respect of, it is an event. There, the price is revised after the appointed day in respect of a previous contract. Then, if the price revision is upwards, that means agreement is entered before the appointed day and price revision happens after the GST date, then the price is revised upwards, then the supplier has to issue debit note. If the price revision happens downwards, the supplier has to issue credit note. That is the provision. Because in GST, in the returns I think might have covered, that is in GST where there is any event transaction related to an original invoice, which is it can be handled by issuing supplementary invoices or debit or credit notes. The same way this provision also handles. This is given and the documents shall be deemed to have been issued in respect of an outward supply made under the GST. This is the provision. We can increase or decrease the value of goods based on issue of debit notes and credit notes. And these will be available for credit with the other person also.
So the credit can vary?
Yes.
The credit of goods already held in stock can vary?
Yes. If a person changes the price, it will be reflected in the outward supply and inward supply.
That
is.
With retrospective effect, the credit can vary?
Yes. Actually, in GST, there is no revision. We are giving a current debit note or credit note against the original invoices, and change will happen in the present outward supply of the current year. Now we have another area, section 154 to 158. These are similar provisions related to refund and recovery. Section 154 to 158 are common in nature. For the first, 154 says that pending refund claims filed before the appointed day to be disposed as per the provisions of the earlier law. This is the provision. If there is any refund, the principle behind the entire thing is that if there is a refund, it will be handled in the earlier law. If there is a recovery, it will be handled under the GST law. That is the basic principle. 155, if there is a sen VAT credit, if there is a proceeding of appeal, revision, review or reference related to any initiated before the appointed day to be disposed under the earlier law. This is a saving clause. Then if as a result of that adjudication any sen VAT credit or VAT credit is liable to be refunded, that has to be refunded under the earlier law, and if there is any recovery, that has to be recovered under the GST law. In the same way, if there is an as part of a proceeding any liability arises under the earlier law, that has to be refunded under paid under the GST law and refunded under the earlier law. And in the same way, as part of any adjudication assessment under the earlier law, any refund happens, it has to be given under the earlier law. Idea is there, it has to be recovered under the current law. These are only circumstances. Like that, revision of return is also there. A person is after appointed date, a person is revising a return under the earlier law, and any refund arises or due to any increase in ITC, then he can claim under the earlier law. And if any idea arises, it will be recovered under the GST law. That is the common principle. This is the principle. Refund of pending or accruing from appeal, etc., it has to be paid in cash in CGST. And SGST, the provisions relating to different state in Kerala we are giving refund like that. Then if the claim is rejected as part of the proceedings, then it will lapse. Then recovery is there. Recovery of the under the earlier law will happen under the as an idea of GST. If there is any amount which is refundable or recoverable under the earlier law, will not be given for ITC under the GST, because it is under the earlier law. This is 154 to 158. Then we have long-term construction and works contract, section 159, progressive periodic supply. Three events are there: how to deal with long-term construction and works contract, how to deal with progressive or periodic supply, 160, retention payments, 161. Three sections. Content of the section is that if one, that is 159, says that if goods or supply, goods and services are supplied after the appointed date and related to a contract which is prior date, then taxable under, supply is taxable under GST. That is 159. Progressive, that is periodic supply items, the goods and services are supplied after the appointed date, but consideration is received prior to the appointed date and the duty is paid under the earlier law, then there is no taxes paid. For example, I have given an example like prepaid services. We have taken a prepaid service, prepaid recharge like thing, and the service payer is tax paying tax under the Yearly Service Tax Act, and we are utilizing the service. We are getting the supply in the GST regime, then no tax is payable. That is a scenario. Now we have no tax retention payments. Same is the principle, goods and services are supplied after the appointed date, part consideration is received, but tax is paid for the full consideration in the under the earlier law, then no tax is payable. Because even though goods are supplied after the appointed date, for the entire consideration we have got tax under the earlier law. So we are granting exemption. For example, if goods is, if we are entering into an agreement for sale of goods and the person is raising invoice and making the entire payment, the party is paying the entire payment, but the supply happens after the appointed date, then he is not eligible he is not making full payment, he is making a part payment, but the dealer is, even though credit transaction, the dealer is paying the entire tax and meeting the liability, and after the appointed date the person is paying the balance amount, then there will be no tax. Yes. Yes. GST, this is the provision. There is a lot of issues in works contract sector. That's why I have said the transition provisions will come more and more. Because Kerala is having compounding scheme and we are entering into an agreement with the party to deal with that case. And there are circumstances like the person is making payment in advance and paying the tax under the compounding, but supply happens later. And supply happens in the pre-GST period and payments are given in the GST period. Some scenarios are addressed, others will follow. First one, goods and services are supplied after the appointed date, but the contract is entered before the date. Because supply happens under the GST, it is treated as. Yes. Okay. Payment is received prior to supply and yes, right. Would send the service. This is to deal with that event only.
Yeah. In that case.
Okay.
If payment is made advanced, if there is advance payment.
If there is advance payment and how he is dealing in the under the earlier law.
He must keep paying
tax. If second one, I think will address goods and services supplied after the appointed date, consideration received prior to the appointed date, duty paid under the earlier law, up to that portion, it will cover. Because these are all scenarios, and when scenario comes, the provision has to be interpreted. Miscellaneous provision, we have some miscellaneous provision, and 162 is there. It deals with ISD, input service distributor. ISD is already covered under the training. It is an office of the supplier of goods and services which receives tax invoices for the purpose of delivering credit, distribution of credit to the units. Under transition provision, there is a provision given which addresses any ISD having any ITC in a pre-GST scenario. It can be carried forwarded, will be available for distribution as credit in GST also. That is, just like ITC of the ISD is also given as credit in GST scenario. For example, if SBI is having a contract for he is getting a ISD for a service for like a AMC or something, and he is having credit, by invoice is raised, but the dealer has not taken credit since the invoice is not received, and he is having he has taken credit under the earlier law, and there is a remaining portion there, then he can claim that in the GST. It's similar to ITC. The provision is there because ISD is a different entity. Now we have tax paid on goods lying with agents. In business, we have scenario where the goods may be with agents, and the principal is having the details of that goods. Under the GST, there is taxable supply between the persons. Then how we have to deal with the goods on the appointed day with the agent. This is the provision. Goods belonging to principal lying with the agent on the appointed day, agent is entitled to take credit, because from the appointed day, he is liable to pay tax. So he has to be given credit. Conditions are there. Agent is registered under GST, and the principal and agent must declare the details in the return file, the details in the uploaded list on the appointed day. Invoices must be related to before 12 months. Principal, and there is another provision there. The principal has either reversed or not availed of the ITC in respect of such goods. It is an important provision, because the principal himself have taken ITC, and he is giving that to the agent. He is not paying any tax. The agent will be collecting, and the principal has to pay the tax. If he is not reversing that ITC, that means two persons will be taking the ITC on the same goods. That is why the provision is there. If the agent can take ITC only if the principal has not taken ITC, and if he has taken, he must reverse it. That is the provision to deal with agent-principal transaction. Now we have treatment of branch transfer. In branch transfer, we have seen that interstate branch transfers are supplied under GST, and there is a circumstance that is specific to SGST law. Like in Kerala VAT Act, we have a provision if a person is making interstate stock transfer, and for example, it is a 14.5% goods, the dealer is given eligible for ITC, not for the 14.5% transferred, but it is limited to above 5%. If he is affecting a stock transfer, that means a sale transaction other than by way of sale. Free transfer he is making, no tax is paying, no output tax is there. But he is having an ITC of 14.5%. Now, he will be claiming that 14.5%. But state laws mainly restrict that ITC to a certain level. We are saying that it is 5%, we are limiting to 5%, then he is eligible for ITC only above 5%, that is 9.5%. This is the scenario. To deal with this scenario, what is the provision is that if branch transfer effect and input tax credit reversed prior to the appointed day, not admissible as ITC under the GST law. For example, if such transfer happens and the dealer had claimed 14.5% ITC in February, and he is effecting stock transfer in March, ITC had already claimed. Now he is affecting He is not clear about whether it will be locally sold or interstate transferred. He don't know. He is claiming ATC. Now the transaction happens. Then legally he has to reverse that 14.5% up to 5%. 5% he has to reverse. And he is paying that reverse tax. That ITC is not eligible for ITC in GST law. That is the provision. Input tax credit reversed prior to the appointed day, not admissible as ITC under the GST law. This is the event. Notwithstanding anything contrary to the contained in the GST Act. This is also something harmful to the dealers. Now we have case of goods sent on approval basis. We are issuing, so dealers are supplying goods on approval basis. They will be supplying goods only after getting approval, they will confirm and make it as a sale. Circumstances are there such that goods sent on approval basis, not earlier than 6 months prior to the appointed date, rejected or not approved by the buyer. Goods are sent for sale on approval basis before the appointed date, but the sale is not confirmed within 6 months from the appointed date. The government will wait for 6 months, whether you confirm it or not. If they are confirming, then it is a sale. If they are not confirming it, what will happen? These are the circumstances. One, rejected goods returned within 6 months. If that goods sent for sale on approval basis is returned within 6 months, no tax is payable because it was removed under the earlier law and it is returned, no transaction happens, no taxable event. But if rejected goods returned after 6 months, there is also extension of 2 months period, then if the goods are also taxable under the GST, then tax is payable by the person returning the goods. Just like a previous provision I have discussed, that is rejected goods returned after 6 months. And then it is tax payable by the person who is returning the goods. 6 months is the period government had decided. Whether it will increase or not, I don't know. Now we have another scenario, goods rejected but not returned within 6 months. Then tax is payable by the goods rejected but not returned within 6 months. Then tax is payable by the person who sent the goods on approval basis. The moment doesn't take place, then it is treated as a supply and the person who had originally sent the goods is liable to pay tax. These are clearly event-based provisions. Now we have collection of tax at source. Goods sold or invoice issued prior to the appointed date. That is the event. And tax was required to be deducted on such a sale under the earlier law. And under the earlier law, such transaction might have been a tedious transaction. Now, the payment is made against such sale on or after the appointed date. The payment happens only after the appointed date. Then there is an issue. Then it will not be considered for TDS under GST. No TDS will apply. Because invoice is raised under the previous law and TDS was required to be effected under the previous law. Only payment is happening after the appointed date. No TDS liability under the GST law. This is also specific to SGST. Now the session is over. In brief, any questions we can discuss. I will not be answering, I will discuss. For this, I will say that if after reading that GST draft law, and our experience in the field and with previous our earlier law like VAT, SEBC, service tax, if we are seeing any inconsistency or issues in practical implementation, that these are the issues that has to be addressed and suggested to our top level and in our public domain, in MyGov it is also available. If we are making it will be very good because these are practical oriented thing. Only people who are dealing with such provisions or who are having a vision of seeing what will happen in GST, how this transaction will be treated, then we may come across some problems. And this has to be addressed in this chapter 25, transition provision. So you can make contributions in this provision and it can increase also. If an agreement is entered, for example, it is 10 lakh rupees and entered before the appointed date, and the after the appointed date, the price changes to 5 lakhs. Okay, the original invoice was issued in relation to the earlier law, and tax was paid just like that. Now the 5 lakh rupees is coming into picture under the new GST law. How to deal with that 5 lakh rupees? That 5 lakh rupees, if it is a price increase, then we are debiting the supplier, debit notice issued, and the supplier has to pay the amount. In that, the other person get a credit also. On the other hand, if it was a 20 lakh transaction in the earlier transaction date and it is reduced to 10 lakhs, the 10 lakhs will be issued as credit note. Now, the supplier can reduce the its tax effect. The important thing is that conditional, downward revision is conditional, because downward revision can result in ITC loss to the state exchequer. Because the person, we are selling, for example, we are under the earlier law, we are paying tax on rupees 20 lakhs. And now under the GST law, it is reduced to 10 lakhs. Okay. The scenario is that the person who is supplying the goods is issuing credit note and he is taking credit of that 10 lakhs. 20 lakhs is reduced to 10 lakhs. He is taking credit. But for the 20 lakhs, the person recipient of the services had already taken credit under the earlier law. So it is compulsory that that person must revise the ITC. Otherwise, so it has to be ensured. That is the provision. Six months is a, something like a, there must be a normal period. Reasonable period must be there. Statute cannot give for long time. Yes. Okay. Okay. Under the VAT. Okay. ITC is taken under the earlier law, and that stock transfer is affecting under the GST law. Then he can transfer, take credit of that ITC through that return carry forward, first provision. 5% he can avail. That is the issue. I was saying that provision is some little bit difficult to trade, because he is paying supply 22 GST rate on the supply he is making after the appointed date. So he must be given credit for the full amount, even for the ITC reversed amount. That is why I said that provision is not good for the trade. 5%. ITC reversed amount is not allowed. Actually, in this case, in this example, ITC is not reversed. So he can claim. If it is the goods are in his possession and reversed before that date, then he is not eligible. The event this provision handles is not correct. So there will be some change in that provision.